Pre-deposit condition, can it be challenged? I'm sorry, there is a typo error. Can it be challenged? In Nandlal and others, Ganesh Yadav, Narayan Chandra Ghosh, all these judgments, it has been very clearly stated by the Supreme Court or High Court that since the right of appeal is subject to the right granted under statute, it is the legislative prerogative to circumscribe that right with any conditions as are deemed fit. And one of such conditions can be the pre-deposit of the amount in dispute. One cannot really challenge that. Allahabad High Court has recently posed the challenge in the context of the erstwhile service tax regime. The question here is, what, however, some glimmer of hope is there, that unless that, what the Supreme Court says, unless the condition is such an onerous condition that it will defeat the very right of appeal, the condition cannot be challenged. This is the sum and substance of the ratio of the principle laid down by the Supreme Court in all these cases. Generally, whether under VAT legislations or IT legislation or under excise service tax or even custom legislation, the challenge to pre-deposit condition before the court have normally failed, almost in every cases. In one unique case of Santilal Sheth, the Mumbai High Court in FEMA case had taken a slightly departing view in the peculiar facts of that case, where it was a case of FEMA and it was a case where the bank guarantee had been executed, and it was a different case where, so it does not really lay down a conclusive law. But otherwise, challenge to the pre-deposit condition, no, there is no fee payable while filing the writ petition with the High Court. Can appeal be rejected if the pre-deposit is not made and hearing necessary before the dismissal of the appeal? If the pre-deposit no made, if you really see the provisions of section 107 and 10112 relating to the pre-deposit, it is very, very peculiarly worded. Unlike the earlier provision where it is pending appeal, one has to make the pre-deposit. However, under the GST, for instance, in section 107 relating to the pre-deposit, the terminology which has been used is very peculiar, which it says, no appeal shall be filed unless the appellant has paid. It means it is practically enjoining upon the appellant to make the pre-deposit beforehand, or at the time of the filing, the pre-deposit challenge should be there. Without that, appeal is liable to be rejected. There is no provision for the admission of the appeal and then thereafter hearing the appeal. There is nothing like admitted the appeal. When they are communicating you the provisional acknowledgement, followed by the final acknowledgement and the number of the appeal, it does not mean that when you file the appeal and provisional acknowledgement, it is admission of the appeal, or final acknowledgement is the admission of the appeal. It is merely the acknowledgement regarding the filing of the appeal, which is taken on records. So there is nothing like in High Court, like we have the writ is admitted, and then thereafter, suppose the notice is issued to the other side, and then the hearing will be undertaken. Nothing is like that. So we should not get confused between admitting the appeal and the hearing of the appeal. However, if the pre-deposit is not made, so without that, as I understand, the online system itself will not allow the appeal to be filed at all. And therefore, the question of filing the appeal without pre-deposit, but principally, it's an academic interest that even for the rejection of the appeal without pre-deposit, hearing must. Similarly, if the deposit is made later, appeal can be restored. These are the judgments. Appeal can be restored by the tribunal. It ought to be restored by the tribunal. This is what the judgments say. However, in the context of GST appeal, I think this provision, this possibility will never arise because appeal will not be allowed to be filed without the pre-deposit. Can the pre-deposit be made by debit in electronic credit ledger amount? Yes, there is a one solitary judgment, but interesting judgment of the tribunal in Dell International Services that pre-deposit can be made in electronic credit ledger amount. The board has also clarified that the such debit can be made in the electronic credit ledger amount. In excise and service tax, it has been a settled law that the any amount of tax or duty can be debited through the SendVat credit account. Interestingly, in this judgment, tribunal has even, basically it was in the context of whether the pre-deposit under excise or service tax, like service tax, can it be debited from the GST credit account. ITC account, which is maintained under GST, can it be used for the payment of service tax or excise pre-deposit? Tribunal says yes. The ITC under GST account, electronic credit ledger account under GST, can be utilized, balance can be utilized for debit for the pre-deposit under excise and service tax. There are board instructions to this effect also on this issue. Next. Cross objection. What is the cross objection? If you see cross objection, when the party has filed an reply before the first authority, and this reply the party has taken for the simplicity's sake, let us assume only two grounds. Forget about penalty and interest. On merits, the demand is challenged, and demand is also challenged on time bar. These two aspects on which. Now, as I was mentioning, the party succeeds, does not succeed on the merit, but it succeeds on the time bar, and the demand is held to be time bar. Under one, the now party decides to, does not decide to file the appeal, though it has lost on the merit. For any reason, they do not file the appeal against that part of the order which has gone against them, which is there on merit. However, the department challenges the order on time bar, which has gone in favor of the party through the review application under section 1073 before the commissioner, first appellate authority. The moment department files this appeal, now I'm talking about the tribunal. There is no provisions for the cross objection before the first appellate authority. However, before when the department files the appeal, that appeal copy is actually communicated to the party, and within 45 days of the communication of the notice of the appeal filed by the other side, which is revenue, the party's right to file the appeal revives in case of the order against merit. This is all relevant for the tribunal. Please understand, there is no provision for the cross objection before the first appellate authority. It was not there even under excise and service tax. However, in tribunal, appellate tribunal, this will become important. So how the process will, what is cross objection? The party challenge the matter before the first authority on merit and time bar. Adjudication went in favor on time bar, but against on merit. Party went into first appellate authority, both on merit and time bar. Again, they lost the same thing on merit, but succeeded on time bar. The department came in time bar, party went into merit. Before the first appellate authority. However, department appeal on time bar is dismissed. Party's appeal on merit is also dismissed. So the status quo is again restored. Party succeeds on time bar, loses on merit. Now, before tribunal, party does not go on merit for any reason, but department continues to fight the case on time bar. So they file the appeal before the tribunal on time bar issue. The moment department files the appeal on time bar issue, the party who has not filed the appeal before tribunal on merit, challenging the demand on merit, their right to file is revived. They can file the cross objection challenging the order of the first appellate authority on merit, against which they have earlier not filed. So cross objection is not the written submission. This is the point I want to hammer in all of you. We are coming across umpteen number of cases in tribunal where the cross objections are nothing but the written submission or reply to the appeal filed by the revenue. Cross objections are not written submissions. It is not the reply to the other opposing party appeal. Cross objection itself is an appeal. It is in the nature of cross appeal. Earlier appeal was not filed by the party. Similarly, the department may not have filed the appeal, right? Against the order, suppose on time bar, party went on fighting the case up to tribunal on merit. The moment appeal is filed on merit before the tribunal, department right to file the cross objection on time bar revives, and department can file the cross objection also on the time bar. For the time limit, it is 45 days. And cross objection to be, once this cross objection, which actually acquires the status of the cross appeal, once it cross objections are actually filed, they are to be heard as if it were an appeal against the order. This makes it very clear that cross objection is not a written submission, it is an appeal. So please do not mistake cross objection as a written submission, which is a common mistake being done by everybody, or by majority of the people. Nick. Condonation of delay. Another important aspect of the appellate mechanism. What is the statutorily prescribed period for the condonation? Before the first appellate authority, it is 1 month. For the party, the appeal filing period is 3 months. For the department, the review application filing period is 6 months. Now, but for both the case, before the first appellate authority, the statutorily condonation period is only 1 month. So department totally gets 7 months and the party gets 4 months altogether with condonation period for filing the appeal. Coming to tribunal, the condonation period is 3 months for both. For department, it is again 3 months and 6 months for actual statutory time limit with a condonation period of 3 months. Now, there are no powers vested in the appellate tribunal for condoning the delay in application filed by the department. This is very interesting. Where the department files an appeal before the tribunal against the order of the appellate authority or before the revisionary authority, they have to file it within 6 months from the date on which the order is passed. When there is no condonation powers vested in the tribunal for condoning the delay. And if these powers are not vested, tribunal, even in the matter of interest of justice, cannot really condone the delay once the powers are not specifically vested. So department will have to be extremely careful to adhere to the time limit of 6 months. I'm coming to that about that issue. Just wait. There are quite a few issues I'm dealing with on this particular condonation aspect. So no powers are vested. Now, the SISTET, another very important departure from the current practices, from the current regime. Under Section 35B of the Excise Act, Section 86 of the Finance Act, and Section 129D of the Custom Act, in all these three cases, there are unlimited powers vested in the tribunal to condone the delay. Tribunal can condone the delay, and in fact, they have condoned the delay even of 3 years and 4 years in filing the appeal in a given justifiable case. However, in a drastic cutdown of these powers, tribunal is now vested under GST with the powers to condone delay only up to 3 months. This is a drastic departure from the practice erstwhile followed, whatever may be the reason, but this is a legislative prerogative. We can't really challenge this, that why earlier there was unlimited power and now it is only 3 months. Next. Coming to the, yes, I'm coming to that. I'm laying down the principle. Friends, let me make one thing very clear. I have not gone into the structure of the tribunal, the benches, how it is going to be formulated, what are the precedent powers, how everything will be decided, how the hearing will take place. Before I continue with the condonation subject, let me say a couple of things. Right now, as everybody knows, GST tribunal is not formed. It's not likely to form in near future. Whether it will ever establish or not, it is a matter of conjectures and guesswork. One can have an educated guess when it will be established. 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, nobody knows. Because the whole set of provision, which are typically bureaucratically structured, absolutely and in the total defiance of the well-settled principles of the law, of the Supreme Court on the constitution of the tribunal, are under challenge before the high courts. The very validity, all these three major provisions, unfortunately, are under challenge. Their constitutionality is challenged before the high court. Provisions relating to appellate tribunal, provisions relating to the advance authority, and provisions relating to anti-profiteering authority. All these three cases, the validity of this provision, constitutionality of these provisions are before the challenge, before different high courts. In fact, in anti-profiteering authority, the batch of petitions are being heard together by the Delhi High Court. And therefore, unless and until the law is streamlined relating to appellate tribunal and it is streamlined in by the well-settled, time-tested principles laid down, pragmatic principles laid down by the Supreme Court, I doubt whether this law itself, the provisions relating to appellate tribunal, will stand the scrutiny of law and whether they will survive at all, unless they are amended. If they are amended in right earnest, sincerely and honestly, then thereafter the process of setting up of the tribunal will start. So right now, the discussion, I have kept it minimum, just on the basic principles, but there are no tribunal. Then what happens if the commissioner appeals, the first appellate authority decides the case against the party, particularly where the refund amount is involved and the refund order in appeal also rejects the refund. I'll come to that about the remedy part in the end of my talk. But right now, there is no tribunal. I'm only evolving because these principles will be applicable before. These principles are applicable even in the context of the first appellate authority. That's why I'm outlining this. Now, for principles and guidelines governing the consideration of application for condonation of dividend, one of the masterpieces of the judgment, which has been time and again cited, is that of the Supreme Court in Collected Land Acquisition Anantnag versus MST Katiji. This Katiji's case, Supreme Court has laid down certain principles and guidelines whereby while considering the condonation application, what factors should be considered. And one thing is very clear, it has been repeatedly held that every day delay should not be explained. The delay, why the delay appeal was filed belatedly and was filed on the last day. Suppose there is a 3 months time limit. So I am not expected to explain that why I did not file on up to 90 days. I have to explain the delay only beyond 91st day. This is the judgment which is laid down. And there are other guidelines. Another very set of important guidelines, very detailed guidelines, have been laid down by the Supreme Court in case of Esa Bhattacharji versus Managing Committee. Very detailed guideline laid down in this case, which will govern not only the GST, but also excise, service tax, customs, and even income tax. Basically, it is in the context of income. Company law cases. This is a corporate case. So, but very, very pragmatic guidelines. So one can refer to this judgment. The other part is, can the first appellate authority or appellate tribunal condone the delay beyond the prescribed time limit? The answer sadly is no. If statutorily 3 months time limit is provided to the tribunal and 1 month is provided to the commissioner, the first appellate authority, as a creature of the statute, all the authorities, including tribunal, are basically creatures of the statute. They are not constitutional authorities. They are creature of the statute. They being the creature of the statute, they have to abide by the law. They cannot go beyond. Even if they are convinced with the reason given for the seeking condonation, they cannot go beyond 3 months. Please bear. And this Supreme Court has very, very clearly laid down in Singh Enterprise case. Can the writ jurisdiction be invoked even after the condonation of delay period is over? In Gujarat High Court larger bench judgment in Panoli Intermediates, the Gujarat High Court has said, yes, the writ jurisdiction under Article 226 of the Constitution is not taken away, and the party aggrieved on a justifiable cause may approach the High Court in the writ jurisdiction if the condonation power period is over. However, in a recent judgment in GlaxoSmithKline, this is a very, very important judgment where even the condonation period was over, there was a belated appeal by the company, matter had gone up to Supreme Court. Supreme Court has discussed, not overruled, but Supreme Court has actually not gone by the Panoli case, taking note of that. And considering the peculiar facts of the dead case, where the party appeared to have been, the company was appeared to be a bit lax or lethargic in following, or maybe misguided in following the appeal the provisions, the appeal stood dismissed on the ground of delay. And this judgment is very important. I have discussed this judgment implications threadbare in my article on Tax India Online titled Remedies Delayed, Remedies Denied. The title of the article is Remedy Delayed, Remedy Denied. It is available on the Tax India Online. and one must take into consideration. Though personally, I feel the GlaxoSmithKline judgment may also need some sort of a reading down, or may require some, not reading down, but it requires some reconsideration. But today, that judgment may have to be kept in mind, that what happens if the condonation period is also over and whether writ jurisdiction can be invoked or not. Next. Coming to now the question about the latest order of the Supreme Court extending the time limit prescribed under any general law or specific law for filing the appeal or any other proceedings, something like sine die, till further orders. The matter is now posted in July, I think 19 July 2021. What is the scope of this particular order? You see, this order, in short, will it apply to the proceeding before the adjudicating authorities, before appeal, and whether it will apply to the appeals under GST? Will it apply to appeal under excise, service tax, customs, or not, before the tribunal or first authority? If the time limit which is prescribed under the law is between the period as specified, starting from 23rd March 2021, 23rd March 2020, as Supreme Court has stated in the order, till the expiring date, then in that case, this order will come to the rescue. It is a specific law like GST or excise or custom or service tax. In my opinion, this extension, which is sine die under Article 141, is actually prescribed under 141, which is binding across the country, will come into the picture. Incidentally, even on the basis of the 23rd March 2020 order, first order by the Supreme Court, when they extended the time limit in the same manner, because this first May order is on, in the continuation of that March order only. Based on that, in somewhere in May or June 2020, Walchandnagar Industries case, Andhra Pradesh High Court itself, in the case of weight assessment, has applied the Supreme Court order, and they have very clearly said that this Supreme Court order of 23rd March 2020 extending the time limit will also apply to the proceedings under the weight assessment. This is a 8425 of 2020 appeal number. It is now reported also in the Tax India online also. I'll give the citation in my note. Under this slide, I will incorporate the citation. And therefore, the question are threefold here. Whether SVLDRA scheme, Sabka Vishwas Legacy Dispute Resolution Scheme, where the time limit expired on 30th June, whether can it be said that this also stood extended in view of the Supreme Court judgment? In my opinion, yes, but it is a debatable contention. Definitely, department is not going to accept, and one may have to go before the High Court of this. Two, whether before the appellate authority or adjudicating authority, if I have not been able to file the refund claim within the time limit, can I now file under GST? Suppose 17, 18 or 18, 19, my time limit, 18, 19 time limit expired after 23rd March 2020. But I did not file, for genuine reason. Can I take the shelter under Supreme Court judgment? Yes, you can, but be prepared for the fight. These are all dispute prone issues. Third, I think there is some disturbance. The third is, what is the status of then the Taxation Laws Amendment Act, whereby the time limit were prescribed for specific purposes under excise, custom, service tax up to particular period. In my opinion, because the Supreme Court first order of extension under Article 141 was already operative at that period when the Taxation Laws Amendment Act was mooted, in my opinion, that time limit will also stand of no relevance, and the Supreme Court order will prevail. Again, these are all the propositions which are required to be tested. But one important thing, if the time limit has already expired before 23rd March 2020, then Supreme Court extension order will not come into play. If the time limit has already expired before 23rd March 2020, then Supreme Court order will not extend, will not revive that time limit. In fact, in another separate order, in connection with the IBC proceeding, Supreme Court, while dealing with this extension, has practically held like this. So one has to be careful. And there the Glaxo judgment, Supreme Court observations will come into play. Coming to the computation part, condonation of delay, as I said, that for when the department moves an application or appeal before the first appellate authority, the time limit is 6 months from the date of communication of the order. If it is appellate tribunal, then it is 6 months from the date on which the order has been passed, but not the date of communication of the order. So there is a marked difference between the languages of the two provisions, where the department is in appeal. Next. In this similar controversy in context of section 35E subsection 3 of Central Excise Act 1944, where the department was empowered to file, commissioner could have filed an appeal before the tribunal, the High Court, the matter went right up to Supreme Court. It was a clear case whether the date of communication of the order should be considered or whether the date of the passing of the order should be considered. The section also used the word for department application, the date of passing of the order. Tribunal said, okay, once it is the date of passing of the order, it cannot be read as date of communication of the order. And therefore, the appeal filed by the department being beyond the time limit, if the date of passing of the order is considered, then it was held to be time barred, and with no power to condone the delay, the appeal was dismissed as time barred. This judgment has been upheld by the Supreme Court in MM Rubber Company's case, one of the celebrity judgments on, because it's an extremely well-written judgment, bringing out the finer nuances of the languages and how the legislature has used the different languages for the purpose of time limit for the filing of the appeal by the appellant and by the department. And once that difference in the language is taken note of, then it cannot be extrapolated. Date of passing the order cannot be extrapolated with the date of communication of the order. This is the basically the sum and substance of the judgment. This judgment will come into play, will be relevant when any such controversy arises in the context of the appeal which is filed by the department before the tribunal. I mean, hypothetically, when the tribunal is constituted, because it is the date of passing of the order. And therefore, one has to see what is the date of passing order and whether the appeal is filed within 6 months from there. I don't know why this distinction has been written for whatever purpose, but it is there. So it will have to be given the full play. Coming to whether any hearing is mandatory before the dismissal of the appeal as time bar, the answer is unequivocal yes. Supreme Court and one of the very important judgment, Delhi High Court, Jesus says, even if the appeal is prima facie time barred, the appellate authority cannot dismiss the appeal without granting the hearing and giving an opportunity to the appellant to explain his matter, whether why it is not time barred. Such issue arises. If it is manifestly time barred, then also hearing is to be given. There is no dispute about that. Sometimes mostly such things arises when there is a issue regarding the service of the order. If there is a dispute regarding the date of service of the order, whether it is not served upon the party or served upon the wrong person or served upon the wrong address, or even though the date of issue is shown as March, most of the order you will be now receiving under GST will be all dated, or maybe excise service tax will be dated 31st March, because they have to show the disposal before 31st March. But the order will be coming to you in May or June or July also. But on file, it is always passed on 31st March. This is the standard thing happening. It is going to create some problem for the department in some days, coming days. But you have to be very careful. Every such communication, one must acknowledge the date by a separate letter, just to be on a safer side, when there is a gap between the date of issue of the order and the date of receive of the order. And always ask, ensure that the envelope containing the order is preserved. No doubt under GST, it will be the online thing, but I'm talking about excise, custom and service tax. Every communication should be actually the date of receipt of the communication when it comes in the physical mode should always be marked with pencil, at least, if not by pen. On the paper, clients should have that habit of writing the date of receipt by pencil, which is very important. And the order when coming after a gap, please preserve the envelope, preserve the speed post if it has come from speed post, do the tracking, keep the record on file, and write to the department that you have received this order on this and this day. Because when there is a gap, invariably the tribunal or commissioner appeal may ask you to give the proof of the receipt. But otherwise, even case of time barred appeal, hearing is a must. Next. If the order date is 31st March and mail is received on 1st appeal, April, then if the order is put online on 1st April, it will be 1st April as the date of receipt of the order. Do the first appellate authority have the powers of remand? This is another raging issue. If you see section 107.11, tribunal definitely has a power to remand. But under 107.11, it says after hearing and after undertaking such examination as deemed fit, the commissioner appeal, that is first appellate authority, shall pass an order which he deems to be fit and proper, confirming, modifying, or annulling the decision or order appealed against. Confirming, he can confirm the adjudication order in toto. He can modify the order partly confirming, partly setting aside. Or he can annulling, he can completely set aside, post the order. But there is no power for the remand. Earlier words, or may refer the case back to the authority for the consideration afresh in light of the directions issued. No such referring back to the. These powers have been taken away, remand powers have been taken away from the commissioner appeals way back on 11th May 2001 in Excise Customs and Service Tax. There is a history behind that. I'm not going into that, but there was spate of remand under the Modvet cases with the department, with the board did not like. And in one of the cases, the commissioner appeal had passed more than 450 orders in two stanches, remanding all the Modvet related cases where the Modvet credit was proposed to be denied on the technical ground. Probably board get too much annoyed and they have actually taken away these powers of the remand. Now, once the powers of remand are not existing, can the appellate authority still remand the case? This is the issue. In MIL India Limited, taking note of this amendment, withdrawing the powers of the remand of the commissioner appeal, Supreme Court has said that once these powers are expressly taken away, the commissioner appeal cannot remand the matter. This has been followed in Greenspan Agritech, same view by Punjab Haryana High Court in MK India. However, in an interesting judgment of 1998 in Umesh Dhai Mode case, in this case, it was a case concerning the customs provisions, Sea Customs Act, where the earlier provisions of the Sea Customs Act had the similar provision of the current 107/11 or 35F of Excise Act, where the powers are taken away. And it also did not allow the commissioner appeal to remand the case. It was same, confirming, modifying, or annulling. The Supreme Court said annulment of the decision when the commissioner appeal remand the matter. Before remand, he has to post the decision. He has to annul the decision. And because the annulment powers are already vested in commissioner appeal, obviously the remand powers can be said to be existing despite not specifically mentioned in the provision. Mark my word, what the Supreme Court said is that before remand, the remand necessarily involves the annulment of the decision. And since the annulment powers are already there, even if there is no express provision for the remand, commissioner appeal can remand the case. This Umesh Dhai Mode case has been then subsequently followed by many tribunal and high court also. However, the tribunal, there are conflicting views. Gujarat High Court in Medico, this is not, yeah, Mumbai High Court in Medico Labs case also. Sorry, it is a Gujarat High Court. There is some mistake. In Medico Labs case has actually said that despite the withdrawal of the powers of the commissioner appeal, he continues to hold these powers of remand. The issue is not yet settled. We will have to just see, but we have to be careful. In Wheel India Limited, the Supreme Court has again reiterated that principle that since the commissioner appeal is entitled to undertake the fresh examination, his order is akin to the order of assessment like the first authority. This is a very, very important observation. And this proposition will have to be tested in the light of law in that post. And therefore, Hanover has to be very careful while filing the appeal and arguing the case before Commissioner Appeal. Put your everything at your disposal before the first authority and first appellate authority. Next. I think I will take another 5 to 10 minutes to complete the discussion. Personal hearing is mandatory. Adjournment of hearing in both the cases, it says adjournment can be given for the sufficient cause, however, not more than 3 adjournments. This is the artificial limit laid down on the tribunal and the commissioner first appellate authority. This prevailed even under GST, excise and service tax and custom. The validity of this can be a subject matter of challenge. It has been also challenged also. But my only suggestion on the practical part of this is, don't ask for the adjournment unless it is absolutely necessary. There was a question like whether I'm required to file the reply within 30 days or not. 30 days is not a statutory time limit. It is an administrative time limit, even if whether the demand is 5 lakh, 5 crore or 500 crore. The so-called notice will always speak about 30 days time limit. Before 30 days, if the reply cannot be filed, don't ask for the extension immediately. Simply say that we deny all the allegations and we propose to file the defense submission in due course of time. Because even if the reply is not filed on the records, hearing will invariably be given. It has to be given. Reply is not a substitute for hearing. Hearing is not a substitute for the reply. And in indirect tax, the beauty of adjudication is that you can file your reply even at the time of the hearing also. So there is no issue about that. And you have to see whether the reply could be filed sufficiently well in time or not. But one need not too much concern about that while not sitting or being negligent also. Then when it comes to hearing, if the adjournment is required to be asked for, please see that the adjournment is asked for the valid reason. Don't get into the standard habit of saying that the director is out of station or I am out of station. I'm talking from the client's perspective. It is a 5-minute job for the officer sitting in the cabin to establish whether you are in Mumbai or whether you are on board the flight to Ahmedabad or in Satabdi Express to Ahmedabad or wherever you claim to be on a given day. So don't give. Don't say that I am not well or director is not well. Don't give the medical. Don't ever manipulate about the facts. Be very sincere. You don't know which matter will also end up in the High Court. And all this will fly hard on your face. So please be very careful. Be very sincere and truthful about the request for adjournment for any reason. Number one, try to see that the 3 adjournments. There is another issue about, can the appellate tribunal will never do that. But can the commissioner appeal or the first authority, commissioner appeal can grant the 3 dates alternatively. Please come on 7th or 15th or 22nd. Will it amount to 3 dates? And if you ask for the adjournment, will it amount to 3 adjournments? The answer is capital N-O, no. There are tribunal decisions that giving multiple dates in the single communication of hearing does not mean that as many hearings are given. Then why not come anywhere between 1 to 30th? Come between 1st June to 30th June. It does not mean that the taxpayer has been given 30 dates altogether. So one need not. But be very careful about this time limit. And always in the request for adjournment, please write that kindly confirm and advise suitably. Don't leave it to. Put it on them that please advise us on my request for adjournment. Always put that sentence. Coming to dismissal of appeal not permissible for non-prosecution. And this is another law which has been raging fire in excise customs and service tax. Can the tribunal dismiss the appeal for non-prosecution? Gujarat High Court in Viral Laminate said no. Supreme Court said no. Madras High Court recent judgment P. Ganesh also said no. Tribunal is bound to hear the, if the hearing is not attended by the appellant and if the adjournment is not likely to be given, the tribunal has to decide the appeal on merits. There is a specific provision under Rule 20 of the state procedure rules whereby the tribunal is empowered to dismiss the appeal for non-prosecution. This Rule 20 has been actually declared ultra vires by Gujarat High Court in Viral Laminate case. Next. Grounds of appeal. Revenue not permitted to make out a new case at appellate stage. This is a, as I said, once the so-called notice is issued and the boundaries are set by the revenue for itself, that will continue to prevail right up to Supreme Court. The litigation or the SOCOS notice in this indirect case is not an old wine which gets better and better by the day. They have to at least stick to the case made out. And these are the series of judgment where, in fact, in Hindustan Polymers case, Supreme Court even castigated the practice, the attitude of the tribunal, that we can understand the anxiety of the tribunal to do the justice and mold the relief. But molding the relief does not mean the revenue is allowed to make out a new case at the appellate level, at the tribunal level, which it never canvassed before the first stage. So these are all in the context of that. Additional ground before the first appellate authority, if any ground is left to be taken, the section 107, subsection 10 has said, addition of new ground not specified in the appeal may be permitted. This is a very funnily worded provision. Addition of any new ground not specified in the appeal. It does not say not, which has not been taken before the adjudicating authority. It says not specified in appeal. Suppose I have taken three grounds before the adjudicating authority, merit, limitation, and computation. And out of these three grounds, when I filed the appeal, I did not take the ground of computation. I missed out on that for any reason. Okay, this provision allows the commissioner appeal to permit me to raise the computation ground, computation of demand ground. But if I have not taken, suppose the computation ground at all in the first adjudication stage, can I take it before the commissioner appeal now? Considering the peculiar language, the answer could be no. Applying the principles of law, the answer could be yes. This language should be kept in mind. And there is another issue. Can these powers be exercised by the commissioner appeals in favor of the department also? It says the appellant. It does not say the department. The department, when files the appeal, is never described as an appellant. So this can be, again, another very interesting debatable issue. Next. No specific mention of additional. Now, section 107, subsection 10 speaks about the additional ground, but nowhere the section speaks about the additional evidence. As against that, but in Mill India case, there are some pertinent observations on additional evidence, and based on that, additional evidence can be furnished. Coming to the tribunal, there is no provision at all for raising additional ground or producing additional evidence. However, when you come to rule 112, it is entire provision is relating to production of additional evidence before both the first and second appellate authority. This rule is practically the reproduction of rule 215 of the Central Excise Rules 1944 or the current rule 5 of the custom appeal rules. So whereby production of additional evidence can be permitted by the appellate authorities subject to the condition prescribed therein. I'm not referring to that, but keep this rule in mind. What is really glaring in this entire provision is the inconsistency between the provision. Section 107, subsection 10 speaks about additional ground permissibility. It does not speak about additional ground not raised before the first authority. But it does not speak about additional evidence at all. Though Rule 112 speaks about additional evidence, rules nowhere speak about the additional ground. Tribunal appeals, there is no mention about additional ground and additional evidence at all. It is in this quagmire, you know, this is a quagmire, nothing else less than that. In this quagmire, let us see certain principles of law. Next. Law relating to additional grounds. One of the two classics on the additional ground permissibility is the Kerala State Cooperative Marketing Federation and Jute Corporation of India Limited. Due to some constraint of time, I'm not referring to their judgment in detail. But this judgment laid down certain principle. The Kerala State Cooperative is basically in the context of income tax, where certain deductions were claimed at the appellate level. And these were permitted. And then Kerala High Court, this was actually, I think, rejected by tribunal. But Kerala High Court, in a very, very lucid and very detailed judgment, referring to a host of cases, including Jute Corporation, they have permitted their deductions, claim regarding deduction to be raised even at the subsequent stage. Jute Corporation is one of the classics on this particular issue. The next is new ground on the basis of subsequent judgment of the High Court. In this particular case, there was a High Court judgment later on involving the same issue in case of another party. The appellant then raised the ground subsequently after High Court judgment, okay, in another party's case, this is the High Court judgment. Tribunal allowed this raising of the ground in Khader knitting case. This ratio will continue to apply even under GST, in my opinion. All this ratio of the principle which I am now referring will continue to hold good even under GST. I have taken up only a very certain important aspects in condonation and additional ground, because these are ultimately revolved around the facts of each case. There cannot be a common yardstick, whether it is condonation, additional ground, or additional evidence. So I am touching upon certain main principles only. Can a new ground of relating to classification be raised for the first time? Answer is yes, in Sinamide India, same volume, 15 ELT. There are many other judgments. I am just only taking over a few judgments. Can plea of limitation be raised for the first time at appeal stage? Answer is yes. Next. Can the question of jurisdiction be raised at the stage of appeal? The answer is yes. Though in certain cases, in some peculiar judgments, the jurisdiction argument was not allowed to be raised on the ground that the party had not raised that ground before the first authority and participated. It could be in the peculiar facts of the case. By and large, the ratio of the judgment is jurisdiction goes to the very roots of the subject. Since the jurisdiction goes to the very roots of the matter, it can be raised, because nobody can invest the authority with jurisdiction by consent. Jurisdiction cannot be invested by consent. It cannot be vested in an authority by consent. Okay, fine, you have no jurisdiction as per law, but I have no problem if you adjudicate the matter. No, this is not permissible. And therefore, jurisdiction ground can be raised at any point of time. Can a pure question of law be raised at the appellate stage? The by and large, the law here is this. If the pure question of law does not require the investigation of any new facts, and the facts are sufficiently available on records to consider that question of law, it can be staged even at the appellate stage, even at the tribunal stage also. Can the issue of dutiability or taxability be raised for the first time at appellate stage? It is dutiability or taxability. In Wheel India case, in the context of that remand powers, Supreme Court said that issue of dutiability goes to the very roots of the matter. It can be raised at any point of time. Similarly, GM engineering works also, and there are a host of other judgments. Next. Law relating to additional evidence. Northern Eastern Railway Admin Gopur, these are certain classic. In this Northern Eastern Railway, the CPC, Civil Procedure Code Section 107, was also followed and was also taken note of for allowing permissibility of the additional evidence. And there are two other Supreme Court judgments which also can be usefully referred to. So, friends, in the end, I will only say this. Instead of remaining at the mercy of the appellate authority, first appellate authority or second appellate authority, sometimes even at the High Court, in the matter of additional ground or additional evidence, one should be very, very clear. One should be very alert in raising all grounds available at his disposal, which he can reasonably think of in fighting the case. Nothing should be left out. There is nothing like minor ground or major ground. Today, a ground may appear to be clutching at the straw, but you never know. You may clutch to that straw, and they may take you safely through the ocean. So never ever consider any ground as a minor or major. Put everything at your disposal at the first adjudication stage only, whether the ground or whether the evidence. Do that, and in that case, so that there is a minimum requirement for you to raise any additional ground. Generally, the necessity to raise the additional ground should arise only and only if there is a subsequent legal development. That should be the criteria, that unless there is a subsequent legal development, like retrospective amendment or some judgment of the tribunal or high court in an identical case, in another party's case, that can be the, but otherwise, this should be the exception rather than a rule. What happens is, even if the additional ground or additional evidence is permitted to be raised by the appellate authority, they will invariably remand the matter on the ground, subject to the power of remand, I'm not going in that, on the ground that since these were never placed before the first authority, we remand the matter back to them for considering the same. So you begin from the beginning after years and years, after decades. And this is all at the cost of the time and energy and money of the taxpayer. And therefore, one should be very, very careful while fighting the case at the first level only. Next. Finality of the order, and this is my final slide. Order is final and binding if not appealed against. So, State of Kerala versus M.K. Kunnikannan Nambiar, Birla Corporation Limited, Bobbing Forces is, and the C.K. Gangadhar and J.K. Charitable Trust. In first three cases, the law laid down is, if an order, even if it is a void order, it is an ex facie erroneous order, even if it is without jurisdiction, that order is binding on the parties unless it is declared to be void or made in law by the higher appellate authority. Otherwise, even a void order is binding on both the parties if not challenged. This is a basic fundamental law governing all jurisdiction, all legislations, including GST. However, if in C.K. Gangadharan case, the appeal was not filed because of the meagerness of the amount, because of some peculiar case facts, and this was held to be in J.K. Charitable Trust case also by Supreme Court, that this will not preclude the department from raising, filing the appeal in another case, even though in one case they have not gone for the appeal. So it may revolve around the facts of the case, but one has to be very clear and very, very careful that no communication which are in the nature of the order or decision is left unappealed. It should be challenged. One should be very diligent about the right of appeal. And finally, the last one, I think appeal to High Court. I'm not going into detail on the High Court, but I will only say this. I will touch upon, as I had heard with Sapnil Ji, that while there is a statutory right of appeal to the High Court and then from there to Supreme Court, one marked distinction between current excise customs and service tax related laws and GST is that High Court jurisdiction has been met in toto. Unlike the current excise custom and service tax, that where the High Court cannot be approached in the matter of interpretation of statute, exemption notification, valuation, and classification. In all these cases, excise custom and service tax, the High Court jurisdiction is barred and one has to go directly to Supreme Court from the tribunal order. However, in case of GST, one can go to the High Court from the tribunal order on any issue, whether ITC, whether interpretation of statute, exemption notification also. And this is the statutory right of appeal. Now, since the tribunal itself is not in operation, the statutory appeal, right of appeal to High Court will right now though will remain in suspension. It will never materialize till the tribunal comes into existence. So it is a miles away. And here I will explain what happens now. What is the remedy available to the in such cases? Today, in a matter of GST, suppose involving transitional credit or involving the ITC or involving the refund of the on exports, appeal is filed, or there is some demand, detention related demand or otherwise. Appeal is filed before the commissioner appeal. First appellate authority has dismissed the appeal. Tribunal is not in operation. What the SSC can do? One, if I'm not mistaken, if my memory serves me right, somewhere in August 20, board has already issued the circular that since the tribunal is yet to be established, the time limit of 3 months for filing the appeal before the tribunal will run from the date when the tribunal is set up and the president acquires the charges and tribunal becomes functional. From the date of president taking over the functions of the tribunal, as and when set up. Suppose tribunal is set up after 3 months, then the order against the commissioner appeal order passed now, appeal against the commissioner order passed now, confirming the demand, the taxpayer will be entitled to file the appeal after 4 years, within 3 months thereof. This is the board circular. And in the meantime, no recovery proceeding will undertaken against the party. So one need not worry about the recovery. Even though appeal is not filed, you have to only write to the department that we have received this order. However, since the tribunal is not in operation, not set up yet, we shall file the appeal as and when the tribunal is set up in terms of the board instruction, cite the board instruction and give that report. And hopefully there will not be any recovery pressure against you. The problem will be when there is an appeal against the refund. If the refund amount involved is very high, I am afraid the only course option will be High Court. And there are many High Court cases. Allahabad High Court has come down very heavily on the board. And as far as the refund is concerned, against the refund, when the appeal is filed, if the refund is rejected, there is no question of pre-deposit. This is obvious. If the refund is rejected, there cannot be any question of pre-deposit because your refund has not been given to you at all. Suppose refund is given to you and it is an erroneously granted refund for which the department has come in appeal. Then also the appellant is not affected. Appellant is not required to deposit any. It is only when the refund which is rejected at the adjudication is granted at adjudication level, refund is also sanctioned and given to the party. Department comes in appeal before first appellate authority. Department of first appellate authority overrules the decision and rejects the refund as not admissible. Party goes to the tribunal as and when set up. At that stage, the pre-deposit will be required because he has already got the refund. But mere rejection of the refund, which is challenged, no pre-deposit is required. Coming back to the remedy, in such cases, if the refund amount is reasonably high, because High Court is a costly affair, the party can approach the High Court saying that cases there is no tribunal which is set up, and under that, in that circumstances, there is no alternative remedy, efficacious, effective remedy to us, and therefore we have approached the High Court. The similar thing can happen for any reason if the department moves for the recovery in case where the commissioner appeal is, the first appellate authority has dismissed the appeal involving the demand. In that case also, and they are not adhering to the board circular, then also High Court writ can lie. The difference between the appeal and writ before the High Court is writ invokes the extraordinary jurisdiction vested in the High Court under Article 226, read with Article 226(1), and whereas the appeal to the High Court is the statutorily recognized appeal powers vested in the appeal, it is a statutorily provided, whereas the writ is under the Constitution, Article 226. And when should one approach the High Court? The tendency to approach the High Court at the drop of the head should be avoided under any circumstances. Unfortunately, in GST, more often than not, one is left with no other alternative remedy but to approach the High Court. And the spate of High Court writ, which is unparalleled in the history of indirect tax, according to me, considering the number of writ petitions which are filed in the High Courts across the country in last 4 years, it has never happened in such a short time, even under the the legislation. However, still one should be very wary. Like, I have an inborn allergy for approaching the High Court immediately at the first instance only, because I know okay, once I'm in the High Court, I can go to the High Court at any stage. But once I'm in the High Court, my doors are closed behind me. This is my presumption. Honorable High Courts can pass any order, can pass any direction with the deemed fit. And therefore, I can only say that one should go with that perception that my bridge is burned behind me the moment I am entering the High Court premises. And one should be careful to avoid this tendency of rushing to the High Court every now and then on every damn issue. As one of the senior most and one of the most respected seniors of this country, and who has been also the additional Solicitor General of India, who has been like my idol, and there is no reservation about taking his name, he is Mr. M. Chandrasekaran. Sir is now practically enjoying his retired life. Has been always telling me, Sailesh, bad judgments are always the results of the bad arguments and bad decisions. And we should be very, very clear when we are making. More often than not, bad judgments are the result of bad arguments. And sometimes the bad option also which we have selected. And then it hurts everybody else. So one should be very clear. When should the High Court can be approached? Can be approached under the writ jurisdiction. And this, the one is about where there is a constitutional challenge to the provisions. No statutory authority up to tribunal can really decide about the constitutional validity of the provision. They cannot declare any provision ultra vires, and therefore High Court is the only option. Like our challenge to ocean freight vagere, these are all the High Court extraordinary jurisdiction. Similarly, if there is a fundamental natural justice violation, which you can relate to Article 14, when there is a fundamental rights, Article 14 or 19(1)(g), if they are violated, Article 21, and this is the personal property and attachment, bank account attachment, this could be, though they are appealable, one can approach the High Court in such cases. Number one. The another is where there is a discrimination. GST is an all India jurisdiction, and the uniformity in the levy is a must in any indirect tax, like which are central taxes, excise, customs, service tax, and GST. These are uniformity is a must. State rate laws were different. There could be different laws, state rates. So in that case, if there is a manifest discrimination in the matter of levy of tax between two identically placed taxpayers, one can think of approaching the High Court in those cases also. So natural justice, constitutional challenge, manifest injustice, breach of fundamental rights, but simply because SOCO's notice has been come, and I am actually aggrieved because SOCO's notice is not it is absurdly issued to me. It is unreasonably issued to me. Why should I get into the litigation? I would challenge the SOCO's notice before the High Court. More, one should be very careful. 9 out of 10 cases, the first alternative remedy argument will be put up by the revenue side. Even when there is a revenue knows that this argument may not be valid, but in SOCO's notice or where order, so means where there is an alternative remedy in the form of adjudication or appeal is provided in law, one should really filter the option 100 times of approaching the High Court. I'm surprised in the case of the demand based on the ITR and TDS, where recently Allahabad High Court has ruled Devi Prasad Tripathi in the favor of advocate, that Orissa High Court, I'm sorry, I think it is Orissa High Court, where they have said that advocate should not be troubled. What happens if the advocate has got an income from the commercial property rental? His legal services are under reverse charge mechanism. But if I have rented out the premises for the commercial income, how can it be exempted? And it may be a different matter if the mechanical demand is issued based on the ITR or TDS. But simpliciter absolving the advocates from the levy of tax, from the demand of tax, because we are under RCM, therefore exempted from the tax and registration, this seems to be a little bit unusual. That Honorable High Court even intervened in these cases. They could have made some suitable direction. Similarly, in the matter of another advocate in the case of Bombay High Court, also, Sanjeev Shah, the intervention of the High Court is a bit baffling and surprising. But anyway, don't take this as a conclusive decision. It can always, another High Court can always take a different view. The point I'm trying to make it is, okay, at the SOCO's notice or at the stage of first order or the adjudication order or second order of appellate authority also, one can go to the High Court, but one should really carefully examine all the facts and options available, and particularly the basis why you are thinking to approach the High Court. Otherwise, it will be a complete waste of time. And in the process, if any particular directions or observations are made by the High Court, then it could completely, permanently damage your case. And lastly, is appeal to Supreme Court. That is fine. That is again a procedural thing. Since these all things start from the tribunal, and these are the appeal starting from the tribunal to High Court to Supreme Court. Tribunal is not in the existence at all, and therefore I'm not going too much into it. I've just tried to touch upon the major areas of the concern. Friends, it has been a marathon session. Lunch will be awaiting you. You have two other marathon sessions in the post-lunch session. And therefore, thanks for the patient hearing. And